Today on the Cinema Shame podcast, Raquel Stecher returns to complete the Rocky saga with a conversation about Rocky 4, Rocky 5, and Rocky Balboa. If you've enjoyed the show and our conversation so far, please stop by our iTunes or Stitcher pages and leave us a review. Better reviews mean better searches, and better searches means reaching earholes of more penitent movie watchers. The Cinema Shame blog is open 24/7. You can find us at cinemashame.wordpress.com. With that out of the way, let's cue up some James Brown and come out of the corner swinging.
Penitent man is humble before God. Before God.
Welcome back to the second episode of the Rocky Conversation with Raquel, the ultimate blogger. Hello, Raquel.
Hi.
My name is James Patrick, in case you've forgotten. And we're back to talk about Rocky 4, 5, and Rocky Balboa, otherwise known as Rocky 6. Some creed may sneak in there, but we'll leave it up to the whims of the conversation. How are you feeling going into Rocky 4, 5, and 6?
I try not to have any expectations going in, and I'm glad that pretty much the entire storyline of the Rocky series was kept for me, and that was a good thing. It was like, I know people hate Rocky V, but I didn't know that people hated Rocky V, so I went into it just with a blank slate.
It's always best. To recap Yes. Our conversation from the first one, we'll do a little mini synopsis here. Mm-hmm. Raquel was very impressed with Rocky I. Less so with Rocky 2, and quite enjoyed Rocky 3 because of Hulk Hogan. And other things, but mostly Hulk Hogan. And that brings us up to Rocky 4, which was released on November 27th, 1985.
The Soviet Union has officially entered professional boxing.
This is not just an exhibition fight. This is us against them.
He would like to compete against anyone who is qualified.
Drago is the most perfectly trained athlete ever. Whatever he hits, he destroys.
He could have stopped the fight. He could have saved his best friend's life.
I'll never forget you, Paul.
But now, the one thing he can't do is walk away.
Has the fight date been set yet?
December 25th.
Where?
It's in Russia.
Are you nuts?
Miss Balboa, when will you be going to Russia?
I'm not going to Russia. I don't know what you're talking about.
He's had one professional fight, and one man is dead.
To Pepe, he's going to have to kill me.
Why can't you change your thinking?
Because I'm a fighter.
You can't win!
More than $125 million in the United States and over $300 million worldwide, which is a very hefty number for the fourth movie in any franchise. It might be interesting to note that Rocky IV was the highest grossing sports movie of all time until The Waterboy. I don't know what that says about us as a movie-going society.
Blame. I saw that at the movie theater. So
did I. But I also saw Rocky IV, so I feel like I evened it out. If you adjust that for inflation, which is always my favorite go-to statistic, the top three grossing sports movies of all time are, do you know? Do you want to guess?
I have no clue.
Number one is Rocky I. Do you see where I'm going with this? Number two is Rocky II. And number three is Rocky IV.
Ah.
So there's kind of a pattern.
Is number three number four?
Don't go off my charts here. I stopped when I got to Rocky IV because that was the relevant piece of information. But sure. We'll say sure. Sure.
Okay.
Although I don't think it did all that well. But we'll say sure.
Oh, that's a shame.
It is a shame. But I think Rocky III has aged better as a result of nostalgia and some of the kitsch value that's contained within. So Rocky IV. Where do we begin with Rocky IV? Should we start with the Soviet fears or the pro-American propaganda, the just Dolph Lundgren-ness of the entire thing?
It is like it could just have been called Rocky the Cold War era.
It could have just been the Cold War, because what we're dealing with here is a movie that's a stand-in for the entire 80s Cold War era.
And that's one of the things I loved about it, how, like, pro-USA. I mean, I don't even really like the actual boxing scenes, but I love the introduction of, you know, like, Rocky coming out, you know, and everyone's booing him, and then, like, you have, like, this Russian propaganda hero worship intro for Drago as he comes in. And then everyone's pro, like, the Russian boxer. And then at the end, everyone's cheering Rocky. It's fantastic.
It is all over the place. It could have just been called Rocky IV diplomatic hyperbole.
I mean, literally Rocky IV world peace.
Yeah. There's a lot of ways we can go with that. And I think that should be an exercise that maybe we undertake on Twitter at some point. But yes, if you're not familiar with the story of Rocky IV, and if you aren't, well, now you should go watch the movie, obviously. So this Russian machine / boxer, Ivan Drago, comes to the U.S. saying that he's defeated everyone in Russia. The Soviet Union, not Russia. We can't say Russia. It's Soviet Union. He wants to come and pummel a bunch of Americans to prove Soviet supremacy. So he has this big press conference and declares that he will take all challengers, and Apollo Creed thinks that this is an excellent excuse to break out the Stars and Stripes shorts again and put on a grand boxing spectacle, self-promotion coming out of retirement party. He has James Brown singing Living in America, and he's got showgirls, and it's everything you'd want Apollo Creed coming out of retirement party to be. I don't think it's a spoiler alert, because it's an early plot point in the movie, but Drago kills Apollo Creed because he just pummels him into submission. And then he's got that very famous Dolph Lundgren line delivery. He dies. Showcasing precisely how inhuman he's supposed to be in this movie, how he is really robot / machine. There's a lot of robot v humanity threads running through this movie that we can get back to later. So Rocky sees this mistreatment of his friend and former foe and says, I'm going to fight him. I'm going to make amends. It's powerful stuff, Raquel.
It is. And I feel like there's some more themes to it, if you watch it closely, that you might miss behind all of the, you know, Soviet Union versus United States stuff and, like, the robot and things like that.
The robot is amazing. We got to spend a whole section talking about the robot, but continue.
There's so many layers to this. Like, I love, like, the Cold War aspect of it. I mean, with the whole scene with Apollo Creed and Living in America, that's like flashy America. It's like, we're, you know, we're unique, we're individualistic, we're expressive, and how dare Russia come in and destroy that for us? Like, we have to fight Russia. We have to fight Soviet Union because they are serious and cold, so that's one thing. And then there's, like, this 1980s love of technology and their love of, like, futurism and just technological advancements. You got the robot and the Rocky home, and then you got, like, Drago's, like, it, like, a very scientific training. And but then, like, if you peel that behind, there's, like, there's also this theme of, like, fighting against yourself. Like, there's this line that Rocky says to Apollo when he's deciding to fight against Drago is, maybe it's you against you. And then, like, I think Apollo follows back saying that if the warrior doesn't have, like, a fight, he might as well be dead.
We gotta change sometime.
I don't wanna change. I like who I am.
I like who you are too, but look at that. You know? You don't wanna believe this, but that ain't us up there no more, pal. We can't do that the way we did it before. We're changing. We're like turning into regular people.
Nah, Stallion. Maybe you think you're changing. But you can't change what you really are. And you can forget all this money and stuff you got all around you, man, because it don't change a thing. You and me? We don't even have a choice. See, we're born with a killer instinct that you can't just turn off and on like some radio. We have to be right in the middle of the action because we're the warriors. And without some challenge, without some damn war to fight, then the warrior may as well be dead, Stallion.
So there's like that battle within yourself. And there's also, it starts with Rocky IV and then it progresses, but this fight against age. But you see it a little bit in the previous ones, but it becomes really apparent in the next few, is that Rocky getting older, you know, and youth escaping him in that battle. So
yeah, both of them really hit on that because they're both retired at this point.
Yeah.
And all they do is spin yarns about their boxing days, and then Apollo sees this opportunity to get back in the ring, and everyone tries to talk him out of it, but and you mentioned the line that's important to that conversation, and this comes up again, especially in Rocky VI,
mm-hmm.
when there's still fight left in them.
Right,
age be damned. Like it doesn't matter how old you are; a competitor is still a competitor.
And I just have to backtrack a little bit and just say how fabulous and how 80s it was that Apollo finds out about Drago, like in the pool, and there's a TV by the pool.
Oh yeah, there's TVs everywhere.
Oh, that's just so fantastic.
But yeah, the 80s-ness of this movie, just that specific time period, 1985, and we talked about Rocky III being very 80s, but this is very 80s in a different way. Rocky III was really about the tone of the film and the way it embraced the montage and the music and the high socks and short shorts. Rocky IV, 1985, is when the 80s really separated itself from the early part when it was just coming out of the 70s and started to embrace this technology. Like, this is the heart of Reagan-era politics, Cold War, robotics, advanced training methods, and the music. Far more so than in the early films, which relied on Conti's score for the most part. Now, it's not even Conti doing the score anymore. He's been replaced by a guy that did synth for Juice Newton, in addition to all of those pop hits we so fondly recall from the Rocky IV soundtrack, which still gets regular play on my turntable. So there's Rocky IV has all this coming together, and Rocky is almost out of place, out of time at this point. Like, he is the dinosaur in this story. And that comes out in the specific battle between Drago and Rocky and their training methods. But let's go back and talk about the robot while we're mentioning the technology.
And that wasn't that Sylvester Stallone's robot? Or he was inspired by his own robot or something?
I'm not sure if it was a specific model. But the robot was a late addition to the screenplay. It was a robot that was used to treat his son's autism.
Ah.
So he was inspired by the way this robot helped his son and wanted to give it a part in the movie. The robot was a card-carrying member of SAG, by the way.
That's awesome.
I don't know if he still has a card, but he at the time he was a SAG member. But the robot does seem sort of tossed in as an afterthought. It has very little narrative functionality beyond giving Paulie someone to talk to that he's not ready to fight all the time. And it is almost just like a comic relief in the film, because outside that robot and Paulie, there really is very little humor to be found.
It's still a fun movie, but it does take itself seriously.
It takes itself very seriously, and some of the fun at this point is, as we've discussed before, sort of unintentional. But even unintentional fun is still fun.
And I have to say, I was watching Glow on Netflix the other day, and there is a scene where all the lady wrestlers are going to the producer's mansion, and he happens to have a robot that looks very similar to the Rocky IV robot. And I wonder if that was inspired by Rocky IV. Like, now that I have seen the Rocky movies, I see references all over the place. But that's one thing that I had noticed.
I didn't think about that, but that, I'm sure that there might be something to that. The robot did gain a bit of a cult following and had some fame. If you talk about Rocky IV with just about anyone, they will bring up the robot.
Of course.
The robot does bleed into the ways that technology is invading the human space. So even though it feels like an extra add-in, thematically, we can say it works.
Yeah, especially when it leads up to that training montage and the, you know, Rocky... maybe I'm skipping ahead, but Rocky training in a very functional, natural way, whereas Drago, I'm saying it. I'm not sure if I'm saying it right.
We swing both ways here.
Okay, I'll say Drago, just I'm more comfortable with that. Him training in a very scientific way. So, I mean, the 80s loved their technology, but yeah, you're right. There was some sort of skepticism of exactly how much it contributed and maybe the downside of it.
Let's talk about the training here while you touched upon that.
Yes! Yay!
I knew that would set your heart afire. So it covers in that sphere of man and machine. Yes. Now, what did you think about, as I should step back, as a certified lover of all things workout related, what did you think of the way that they showed Drago's training?
That is actually my favorite training sequence of all the Rocky movies. Let me just say that. It battles with number 3 because I love that one so much too. But this one happens just to be my favorite at the moment. I thought it was really interesting because my own personal methodology when it comes to exercise is more functional movement. And that's what Rocky is doing in his training, whereas Drago is training with like scientists. Everything is timed and measured, and he's doing things that Rocky is doing, but Rocky is doing them against like real objects where Drago is using machines. And I just think that, I mean, it's one way of training, but I don't think it's the most effective way, just because your body's built to do things in nature. You know, you're meant to lift things and pull things, not just, you know, sit in a thing and just flex your quadriceps, you know, over and over again, time to a scientist's, you know, like paperwork or whatever.
The rationality behind the Russian training is that it measures precise movements to perform your exact sport. So they had these team of it's worth noting that they mentioned that the team is Russian and Cuban scientists. Just to kick in that extra little Cold War.
I missed that part.
Yeah, it's just kind of an aside thing, but I made a note of that. because I thought it was interesting, because there's otherwise there's no reason to make a point to say that there's Cuban scientists, because I mean, why, who goes down to Cuba to find your scientists, really? So they're using these techniques to remove the wasted motion in, mm-hmm. in the training and focus all energies to specific muscles and movement. And this was actually the training that is used in the film was actually being created then by these athletic trainers and scientists. So what they're doing is real stuff in the movie. It's not just bells right. and whistles and gizmos and gadgets like 1950 science fiction movies. And some
he tests,
of
like all sorts of things like aerobic capacity with the running. And then there's, I really love the part where he, they're measuring the strength of his punch. That was in like the, I don't know, pounds per pressure, like, or right. whatever it was. I thought that was super interesting. Like there, I mean, he's doing like real Olympic lifting movements and all sorts of things.
And the technology that was developed by these scientists that was put into Rocky IV, it took more than 20 years before a lot of this very same technology to be used in athletic training.
Mm-hmm.
I found that interesting because when you read up about it and you dig back into it, because you know, you're watching Rocky IV at the time and it seems super science fiction-y, like all these breathing apparatuses and computers, and while some of it is clearly done for show and the spectacle of the film, there is real truth and science behind these contraptions. The old school trainers were still relying upon Rocky's methods, and there was an interesting anecdote on the wiki page that said that Ryan Lochte and Michael Phelps were so inspired by Rocky IV that they had a trip to some frozen tundra to do their workouts as well before one of the Olympics.
Interesting. Yeah, so, no, that I agree with what you're saying. Like that whole sequence was ahead of its time, and it's really interesting how that scientific part of it just basically came about later, and it seemed futuristic at the time, and it was. And it just pretty much predicted what was going to happen in exercise. I just think that, like, right now I'm personally moving towards what Rocky was doing. And I think it's interesting to compare, too, with the training sequence in number 4 and the training sequence in number 3. Where, like, in number 3, he was training, not the one he's training with Apollo, but the one where he's just training and, like, there's a bunch of, it's like, pomp and circumstance. There's like models there and like a bunch of people and they're drinking and he's just working out. And then Mr. T Clubber Lang is really getting down and dirty in the gym and really training. And that's an interesting comparison of like there you have like the famous Rocky training, and then you have like kind of the evil underdog kind of training. And then in this one, it's flipped. Like Rocky is getting down and dirty with his exercise, and Drago has everything available to him, like everything he could want. So he's got like the silver spoon of exercise or whatever you want.
Yeah, there's throughout the Rocky films, there's this constant pull back to simplicity and pull back to your roots. It's almost like soul versus soullessness,
right?
Simplicity versus extravagance,
and the extravagance always loses.
Again, there's so many oppositions in this movie, so we're again touching on this old school roots, like old way is better, soul versus the modern atrophy,
right?
And Rocky IV really hammers that home. That's pretty much the entire film. Once you set up the, especially this training montage, like you're talking about, where Rocky's chopping trees and hauling logs and pulling sleds and climbing the tallest peaks in Russia / Wyoming.
And then I love that moment when Drago has the barbell with the plates and he's pushing it overhead. And then, like, I think it's like Duke, Polly, and Adrian in like the big wheelbarrow, and then Rocky is pushing them over his head. It's fantastic.
There's a lot of fun comparisons in that training montage. My wife and I were watching it. I don't think she had seen this movie either. She'd probably seen bits and pieces like everybody has over the course of time, because this movie was a regular staple on cable television. The helicopter shot when Rocky climbs the mountain.
Yeah.
It is, her exact quote was, "Are you fucking kidding me?" It's so silly. The way that training montage ends.
But you kind of have to have it.
Right. You need it.
Yeah.
I think that's where I was going with that.
That's the part of the fun of the movie too, is that level of cheesiness.
It is. And, the part of it's because the film is extra grainy because it was shot at dusk and you've got this long helicopter shot circling overhead, and you have Rocky running up the steps of the Philadelphia Art Museum. So what can top that? You know,
right.
Like, this is the next level shit of climbing the art museum steps is this mountain. It's one of those moments that you want to roll your eyes, and I think many people do. But it also stirs something inside you as a fan of these films. I wouldn't say that it's that your enjoyment necessarily is devoid of irony, but you can appreciate it as something more than.
Maybe this speaks to my personality, but when he climbed that mountain, I almost got out of my chair and started like pumping my fists in the air. I think I might have done some fist pumping at one point, but it just got me so riled up in a good way. I bought it hook, line, and sinker.
This is exactly what we're talking about. See, I mean, the Rocky films, they always walk this line. Well, until we'll get to that in a second, but they walk this line.
Yeah.
And they did it so well through Rocky 3 and 4. Now, we're not saying they're great films, but they're very effective films.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that mountain peak scene kind of summarizes the way that they just go right up to the edge of falling right off that. But we're still in it.
Yeah.
Some of the contemporary reviews for Rocky IV were not especially glowing. Roger Ebert said the series finally has lost its legs. It's a last gasp of a film franchise that's so predictable. It's like watching those old sitcoms where the characters never change and the same situations come up and up again. That was kind of the general feeling about the film. Audiences clearly reacted to it, as we talked about the box office take. And you talk to people today, and they still recall the film fondly. It, you know, at a certain age, I was of a certain age when this movie came out, that it seemed like just about the best thing in the world at that point. It really works on kids, because it's such a base level opposition. They've created the ultimate evil and the ultimate good.
Mm-hmm.
There's no mistaking who's on what team. Once you kill Apollo Creed and there's no remorse, you're like, oh, he's evil. We have to go get him. And then we go get him. But there's also this reconciliation and middle ground when the Russian crowd turns to Rocky's side, and Rocky comes up and he's humble and saying,
"I was trying to say is that if I can change,
я думаю, что каждый тоже изменился.
And you can change.
Вы можете измениться.
Everybody can change. Каждый может измениться.
It's not deep. I mean, it's terrible. Like that's your big speech, but in the film you're swept up in it and you're like,
oh
yes,
yeah,
Rocky, you're
I know it's high good. Emotion you'll take anything.
Yeah,
I have to say I had a couple of issues with the movie. I mean, I thoroughly enjoyed Rocky IV for all its themes and all the technology and the Cold War, everything. I just bought into everything. But I have to say, like, Adrian's character, lacking, seriously. And she kind of has to lack because she's his wife, the mother of his child. I mean, she is concerned about him. And the longer they've been together, the more invested she is in him. So she has to be that voice of doubt. I mean, he needs a voice of doubt. But it's become that's all she does, really, in the narrative, which is really sad because she was such a fantastic character.
She was so vital in the first two films, less so in three. And in Talia, in number four, Talia Shire really just doesn't seem to care. I can't blame her. Her performance is pretty weak.
Yeah.
The role is written poorly. She's really just limited to window dressing. And then, you know, she's given the obligatory, you know, doubt scene and then ultimate support, which is, we've discussed, is essential to Rocky's character, the support of Adrian.
Right.
So again, like Roger Ebert said, it's the predictable beats. You have to plant that seed of doubt and then have her come back, give him reason and motivation to believe in himself again.
And she just shows up in Siberia.
Because you do.
Yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to point out, too, Brigitte Nielsen, because, I mean, I was wait, you said it came out in November 1985?
Yeah, November 85.
So I was just 5 years old when this came out, but I remember Brigitte Nielsen and Sylvester Stallone being the hot couple, the hot celebrity couple of the era.
Yep.
And how huge that was. And from what I understand, like, they had written her role into the movie so that she could be in it. But I just, she's a character. She's there. Sylvester Stallone is in it. She's in it. But
you know, I kind of, did you watch Key and Peele?
No.
So in the sketch comedy show, Key and Peele, Jordan Peele, Keegan-Michael Key played Obama's anger translator character. Jordan Peele played Obama, and Jordan Peele would give the minimal safe response, and Key would spin it and turn it into this rampage of anger. And like, so I kind of felt like, having seen that and now having seen Rocky IV again, that because Lundgren's character has something like 42 words total in the film, something ridiculous like that.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
And he says so little with so little emotion that Brigitte Nielsen was his anchor translator.
Right.
Just because she is the one that's just yammering just nonsense the whole time.
Right.
Like she serves no purpose. And we really didn't need her to be super annoying. And I guess we could note here that she did win the Raspberry. I think she won two because they couldn't give her enough. She won for like supporting actress and new star or something like that because of this in Red Sonja.
Dang.
But she was everywhere for a hot minute, and then who knows what she's doing now. Is she doing anything? Have you seen her lately?
I have not.
I don't know.
Like, my husband asked, like, what is she up to these days? What does she look like? I was like, of course, it's...
I think I asked that question myself, but didn't feel compelled enough to actually look it up. So that's how far she's fallen. From that brief minute of infamy.
Yeah, it's funny actually watching the Rocky movies with your spouse. Like you said, you watched it with your wife. I watched every single movie with my husband Carlos, which was great. I thought it was really fun that he insisted on being part of it with me. This is kind of a nice couple thing to do. But he would just yell out some things like fake, or he said Cold War propaganda for this movie. It was interesting to see his reactions, and some of the things, like, he's like, Raquel, don't forget to mention this in the podcast. I was like, okay, I'll write it down. It's a nice couple thing to share.
It is. It is. Yeah, my wife was really into it. Every day she's like, "So we're watching Rocky again tonight, right?" I'm like, "Yeah, we're watching Rocky. We got more." It was fun because you could see how invested she got in her response to Rocky V, because she was so angry at Rocky V that you could tell, like, she was really into the first four. And then when Rocky V comes around, she's like, "What is this nonsense?" I'm like, I know. I tried to warn you that tonight was not going to be great. I had a couple more points about Rocky IV that I thought was interesting. The score I mentioned earlier was Vince DiCola. He did the music for Transformers the movie, the animated film, and Staying Alive. But he was also nominated for a Razzie for his score in the film, which I don't think is bad. It does not feature You're Gonna Fly Now.
Mm-hmm.
It samples it. He samples it a little bit. But I think it's interesting in a historical perspective to consider how this film treats technology and how critics responded to DiCola's synthetic score. They hated it. And listening to it now, it seems dated in that this is sort of the beginning of the electronic music movement. But I don't think it's bad.
Mm-hmm.
I just don't think they knew what to do with it. I mean, he was pioneering some electronic music techniques that would become staples, the electronic sequencing that he was doing in that film. So historically, it's an interesting footnote. But unfortunately for him at the time, he didn't get a whole lot of work in movies, perhaps as a result of him being slightly ahead of the game. But music plays such a vital role in Rocky.
Yeah.
That the deviation must have rubbed people the wrong way. And it is, for the most part, still, like I mentioned earlier, a poppier score. It's a lot of popular music, and the score is pushed back. That trend continues through Rocky V to much more egregious results. I don't know if you had any feelings about the score in Rocky IV, if you noticed anything about it in particular.
See, I have maybe a blind spot when it comes to music, but one of the things I did try to pay more attention to was just how the theme was used in all of the movies. You're the music expert, so I'll rely on your... I enjoyed the music in Rocky IV.
But yeah, the pop music is used throughout the film, and that might be a result of the way they felt about the score. I don't know anything, any particulars about how that came together.
From what I read, wasn't Living in America, like, I don't know, launched with this movie? Wasn't it for this movie and then became a hit later? Or am I thinking something else?
That's possible. I don't know. I don't remember the song before then.
So one thing, it maybe established a...
I think it probably brought James Brown back.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I know that he had a big tour after this film, so he may have reemerged in the public conscience to a new generation. I know that he toured with the robot, as an anecdote. He brought the robot on tour with him.
That robot, seriously. They should have just made a Rocky movie with a robot.
It would have been interesting. I probably would have watched it.
Yeah, I probably would have watched it too.
And I also liked the one thing I was shocked about in Rocky IV. We talked about the importance of the montage in Rocky III, but in Rocky IV, we actually get a montage made up of montages.
Oh my gosh.
When after Drago kills Apollo Creed and Rocky's doing his soul searching and trying to figure out what he's supposed to do, he gets in his Lamborghini and he just drives, right? And he's thinking about the past. And it comes up in this epic clip montage from all of his previous movies. And the scenes in the montage were taken from other Rocky montages. Okay. I just thought that was such a meta moment.
I thought that's the one moment where I rolled my eyes and I was like, oh, God.
Well, it's just him driving and he's getting angry and fired up and thinking about the past. And like that's...
Yeah.
But I do love that there's a montage made up of montages.
Yeah.
Because it's just so Rocky.
It is so Rocky.
The other note I had down that I thought was interesting was that the guy that played not Mikhail Gorbachev at the fight at the end, who's clearly Mikhail Gorbachev, but not for purposes of the film. He also played not Mikhail Gorbachev in The Naked Gun. Same actor.
Interesting.
It's pub trivia. I don't know where that's going to come up, but.
You got typecasted.
Yeah, his name was David Lloyd Austin.
Okay.
So, David Lloyd Austin, here's your 2 minutes of podcast notoriety. Unless you have anything you'd like to close out the Rocky IV conversation with, I am out of tidbits and factoids that I wanted to talk about.
I am good. Are we taking a short break?
We can take a short break because I need you to prepare for a game we're going to play called the Hot Minute of Cinema Shame.
Okay. Sounds good.
You need to prepare your knowledge about film franchises that lasted for 5 or more entries.
Oh dear. I'm going to fail miserably.
Oh, did you see the first round where Rocky and Lundgren, well, Stallone and Lundgren fight was real boxing? Stallone thought it'd be great for the movie if they actually did some sparring to open. Mm-hmm. And shortly in, so you don't get much of it in that first round because Lundgren punched Stallone so hard that he bruised his heart, and he was in intensive care for 8 days.
He could have died.
He could have. Yeah. Eight days in intensive care is pretty serious.
That is very serious.
Rocky said that Lundgren could have fought professionally.
He added like a crazy amount. That guy was massive. I don't know.
He was a big dude. And then he.
Big guy. Yeah. And I read somewhere in the trivia that they were trying to estimate exactly how many pounds he was pressing over his head. And I think it was like somewhere upwards, like over 300 pounds or something, which is like. Ridiculous. Also, the way he did it, he could have broken his back.
Yeah.
He didn't do it correctly.
It just looks painful. It just looked painful.
It's not good form. Actually, that's one of my beefs with the Rocky movies is that there's a lot of bad training.
Yeah, well, they didn't have to do it all over and over again, so they get away with one or two bad presses, I guess.
Yes, yes. But, like, also, our, you know, knowledge of good form has changed over the years. So one of the things I love about the 80s is that the bad exercise montages or, you know, segments in different movies, you're like, wow, I would never do that because it's not effective and I could hurt myself.
Yeah. So, as I mentioned earlier, I am going to throw you into the first ever Hot Minute of Cinema Shame quiz. Okay. All right.
I'm getting my shame ready to go.
Get it. All right. So, because this is the first episodes to tackle an entire series of films,
mm-hmm.
and Rocky series proper has gone on through 6 entries, and since Rocky V, we may not have a lot of interesting things to say about it, I thought I'd focus on the 5th entry as a nice little benchmark.
Okay.
So, I am going to name the title of the 5th entry in a bunch of different series. I need you to tell me the series from which that movie comes from.
Oh, dear. I'm scared.
You should be. For the home listeners, feel free to play at home. See how well you do on the Cinema Shame Hot Minute. I will say, I'll give you a minute, and we'll see how many you can get in a minute. But what I'm really going to do is just run through them all, and we'll see how many you can get.
Okay.
Okay? You ready?
Yep.
You found your center?
Yes.
Okay, good. The Dream Child.
That sounds like it's from the 80s.
Series originated in the 80s.
Series originated in the 80s, The Dream Child. Shoot. I don't know.
Nightmare on Elm Street.
Oh, okay. See, I don't have very much knowledge of the horror movies, so I'm lost there.
Next one. This one is not a horror movie. It's about as far away you can get. Off the Leash! Exclamation point.
Off the Leash? Like a series of dog movies? Like Benji or something?
Benji is correct.
Yes!
It is the fifth Benji movie.
Oh, I used to love those as a kid.
The Face of Death.
Face of Death.
I'll give you a hint. One of the words in the series is in the title of that film.
I don't know.
Death Wish.
Death Wish.
Death Wish.
See, my experience is like my knowledge is more of the earlier stuff, so this is going to be tough.
Yeah, there aren't a whole lot of early series that went to six films. That were actually like part of a real series. I mean, you could talk like Falcon, but they were really like,
Charlie Chan, the Andy Hardys.
Yeah. Yeah. They're more serialized. I don't know. I eliminated some of those because I didn't feel like they qualified. Also, these movies are more fun to make fun of.
Oh, man, that's the stuff I know, though.
Yes. Old serials. But we're in the 80s now, so. Here's one that should be a little easier. The Deadpool.
Oh, no.
I thought this was a gimme.
Oh, no. Seriously, I'm like, classic movies is my expertise.
Well, the first in this series would be considered a classic film.
Is this a recent release?
No.
No. I have no clue.
Dirty Harry.
Dirty Harry, okay. Man, got one for how many? Five?
Oh, we're not done. Assignment Miami Beach. I'll give you a hint. We covered the first film in Cinema Shame. First episode.
Oh, is it, the police movies?
Police no. Academy movies, yes.
Police Academy.
Yes, it is the first Police Academy movie without the Gutenberg.
Okay.
Collision.
I remember that episode. That was a good episode.
I thought it was pretty good. Came out pretty well.
Yeah.
I don't think Will McKinley made it to five, though. Pretty sure. Collision Course.
Like Rambo or something? No.
Ice Age. And the last one. All In.
Oh, that sounds like it could be a sports series, but probably not. I don't know.
I believe it would count as a sports series.
I have
Athletic,
no clue.
Athletic, at the very least.
I have no clue.
Apparently, you need to brush up on your Step Up series. Step Up.
Step Up?
Step Up.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Man, I failed miserably. I got two, right? That's it?
Two. I left off the other horror movies.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. There was also A New Beginning, Friday the 13th. Seed of Chucky, Child's Play.
Oh.
Fields of Terror, Children of the Corn. I enjoy that title, Fields of Terror.
Yeah, it's a good one.
Yeah. In the Hood. Leprechaun, In the Hood. It's pretty amazing.
Man, we really liked series in the 80s, didn't we?
We had a penchant. I just found it remarkable that there are so few fifth entries that really provided anything worth remembering.
Yeah, that's tough. Once you get to number five, I mean, there's basically a fatigue where people are no longer interested.
I'd remove series that were kind of pre-planned. Like, you have Harry Potter and...
Yeah. Like, you know that there are seven books, yeah. So there'll be...
I thought that was cheating.
Seven plus one.
You're not developing a new idea, a new property every time out.
Right.
But, yeah. I think an interesting exercise would be to, the top five fifth entries... If you could even come up with five decent ones.
Or no.
You might have to, just to come up with five decent movies. You can see where we're going with Rocky V.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Poor Rocky V.
Poor Rocky V. Let's play the trailer. Because that's terrible, too. It'll give you...
Not seen the trailer. Well, oh gosh.
I'll insert the trailer here. Yeah, it sounds like a terrible movie.
From a million to one shot, he became a true champion of the world. Now, the glory.
Because of the continuous violent blows to the head, the effects are irreversible.
The crowds.
My husband is retired. He has nothing more to prove.
And the money are gone.
You lost millions.
Look, I still got my place in the old neighborhood.
His title is in the hands of a new champion.
He might win a few fights, but he's no Rocky Balboa.
Controlled by an unscrupulous promoter.
This is your medical report. It's not so good, but we can work around it.
All that's left is his family.
We've been down before. I'll get it all back.
His heart.
I gotta fight, okay? I got problems, I gotta fight.
And a dream. A dream to get it all back.
This is a tremendous opportunity.
Opportunity for who? For you to make money for him to be disabled?
You know he can't carry Balboa's gloves.
As long as they got Balboa in the brain, he'll always be champ.
Got to challenge that man to fight. And if he refuses, then you got to insult him. You got to dog him. You got to humiliate him. You got to do whatever you got to do to get him into that ring.
You tell me, you're a piece of garbage, you know that?
No! That's it!
You told him I'd fight anywhere, anytime.
In the ring. Tommy Gunn only fights in the ring.
My ring's outside.
Yeah. Let's do it.
Come on, Tommy, knock me out!
Yeah, so Rocky V marked the return of John G. Avildsen as director. It was released on November 16th, 1990. It cost $42 million to make. I have no idea where that money went. Maybe to MC Hammer for the rights to that one terrible song he contributed. It only made $40 million in the U.S. and $119 worldwide. So that is what one might call a bomb. United Artists dropped the franchise immediately following. Reception was generally poor. I did manage to find a positive quote from Janet Maslin. So let's go with that so we're not all negative. She calls it sloppy but good-natured reminder of just what has kept Rocky Balboa afloat for 14 years. He was and is a role model. rare to film, and rare to society. So it's got that going for it. The review was not overwhelmingly positive, but it did focus on what the Rocky Balboa character meant and continued to mean in 1990. The story goes, Rocky gets off the plane from Russia. The fight has clearly aged him approximately 5 years. His son also has felt the effects, and he is now a teenager. After being, what, 9 in Rocky IV? Mm-hmm. And Rocky is hanging them up once again. He is immediately assaulted by boxing promoter George Washington Duke, who demands that he fights his champion Union Kane. Rocky doesn't want any part of it, goes home to lounge in his posh mansion, only to learn that Polly gave Rocky's accountant power of attorney. Rocky's accountant had subsequently blown his entire fortune on bum real estate deals and neglected to pay his taxes. So Rocky's flat broke, moves back to South Philly, finds his old leather jacket, his old pork pie hat. Adrian goes back to work at the pet shop. Polly goes back to working in the meatpacking plant. And Rocky decides to start up Mickey's old gym. Along the way, he has a meet cute with completely awful actor Tommy Morrison, aka Tommy Gunn, who demands that he fights, demands that he trains him to fight.
Tommy the Machine Gun.
Tommy the Machine Gun. Tommy the Machine Gun. Thoughts?
They should have stopped with Rocky IV. You know what? It would have been great if it stopped with Rocky IV and Rocky Balboa was the coda. Correct. But Rocky V was just not necessary. And it's not for lack of trying. Like, it had some things going for it. Like, you have Rocky's transition to mentor with a protege. Then you have his, you know, riches to rags and getting back to his old neighborhood. And then his relationship with his son is very fleshed out in this. And it's an opportunity for him to work with the son's sage salon. It took itself more seriously. It explored the whole physical aspect of, like, the physical toll that boxing takes on these athletes with, like, the brain damage. And this is something that was explored in number 2 with his eye injury. Mm-hmm. But it's not really explored in any of the other films. I mean, it's got stuff going for it, but it just completely falls apart and takes too long on certain story points. It just takes itself way too seriously, which makes it cheesy in a bad way, whereas, like, the others were cheesy in a good way. It's just not very enjoyable. But it had potential. It just did not reach that point.
It's a story that was done better later.
Right.
The Rocky, some of this is redone in Rocky Balboa, Rocky VI, the aging fighter, overcoming personal demons, what everybody tells him he can do. Then in Creed, you know, the taking of the protege, training him. It's handled with much more finesse.
Right.
This movie is the blunt force trauma of the awkward early 90s cinema. There's a lot of bad filmmaking, ineffective characters, and poorly written. The editing of the film is a disaster.
Yeah.
It takes too long to get anywhere. Music, which plays such a vital role in the series, is just awful. It's filled with rap music, and I love early 90s rap music. but it's quite amazing how bad the music they used in this movie really was. It reeked of white people picking music they thought was popular. It did. I mean, you've got MC Hammer and Rob Bass, people who are capable of producing something decent, but the music is groan worthy. It really pulls you out of the film too.
And it's a tough time, 1990.
There's some growing pains.
Transitioning out of the 80s, still trying to figure out what's the next step. So it's kind of that was a tough year.
There's really no score to speak of in the film.
Right.
It's all rap music until you get to the end credits when magically Elton John appears.
Oh yeah.
Well, while we've been talking about raspberries, he won a raspberry for that song.
Oh, really?
He did. Not that it's, you know, I don't cite them as benchmarks. I cite them as more like a representation of popular opinion at the time.
Right. I wonder if you pluck this movie out of the Rocky series and clean it up a bit, if it would have been a better movie. Like, in the Rocky series, it just doesn't work. But if, as a movie about an aging boxer, it had potential.
There is some interesting things that fell flat in execution.
Mm-hmm.
Tommy Gunn's character is so unlikable.
Yeah, you really don't like him.
That benefits the only decent moment in the film when Rocky pummels him in the street fight at the end, which... What the street fight is the interesting part of this film. That is it. For the rest of the film, Tommy Gunn is really just a menace to the screen. Not just because of the way the character's written, but because Tommy Morrison is really a terrible actor.
Yeah. And also, like, there's no evolution with his character. It's just he flips a switch. Like, he becomes, like, you know, he goes from Rocky's protege, who really admires him, to just under the control of this, like, big... like the George Washington Duke kind of Don King-like character.
The not Don King character, who is clearly Don King.
Man, what the hell happened in there? I want the damn title of these people think I'm a bum! Man, why didn't you take it from me in there?
Oh, listen to me. When the press is right, they're right.
Right! Man, I'm as good as Babbo ever was. I don't give a damn what they say, and I'm tired of being called a damn robot, too!
Listen to me, Tommy Gunn. You can't fight the press. I can't fight the dog fight the press. And as long as they got Balboa in the brain, he'll always be champ. The man fought wars in the ring.
Tommy, face facts. You're in his shadow. I don't know if there's any way out.
Man, this is your old man talking.
No. Listen to me. There's a way for you to get the respect you deserve, but what you got to do is challenge Balboa to fight man to man.
That's right. Georgia can set this fight up abroad in a matter of weeks.
Oh, yeah. It'd be the greatest fight ever. Teacher against student. Old lion against young lion. And it's the only way you're ever going to get peace of mind, because believe me when I tell you, that press is going to hound you with that man's legend for as long as you dare to wear boxing gloves. You got to get him into that ring, Tommy Gunn. Or you're going to be in question like you heard tonight for the rest of your life. Then you're going to start to ask yourself, could I really take him? Am I really good enough? Do people really think I'm a cheap carbon copy or a second-rate pretender who only got a shot because of my skin tone?
We exactly. Really didn't bother to gloss that over at all.
No, this is just Don King with another name. And it just he buys into that, and there's no progression. It's just... it switches, and then, he's just not a very good actor, and you're already kind of skeptical about him now. It's like, ugh, this is terrible.
Yeah, and Rocky has an ugly side here when he's living vicariously through his protege segment is painful.
A lot of the Rocky and Rocky Jr. scenes were kind of painful to watch.
The dialogue.
Yeah.
It's torturous at times. The way that it just, there's no nuance at all. And I'm not saying that the Rocky series is a bastion of nuance beyond maybe the first one.
Mm-hmm.
But this is, it's rough. And his son's no actor either.
And I'm surprised. I know that Sylvester Stallone really just hated this movie and kind of tried to divorce himself from it. But I wonder why he didn't feel maybe more attachment to it, considering that his son is in it with him. And this is something that they shared together. And then his son died in 2012. So, like, out of all the Rocky movies, I mean, I know he just dismisses this one, but I wonder I mean, did he enjoy making this with his son? Like, is there any connection to it that could salvage it for him? Because he invested so much of his life into these.
He did. I've never read anything positive from him about this film. He said he did it because he wanted the money. United Artists wanted to make another movie, and they threw a ton of cash at him, and he said he'd do it.
Can I just say, I don't know if I'm skipping ahead, but I'm kind of glad that they didn't go with the original ending of Rocky dying during the street fight, because I feel like that would have just, I mean, obviously that would have ended the series completely, unless you did like a prequel or something.
Yeah, it would have deprived us of two good entries.
It would have made it it's a terrible movie, but it would have made it just like the worst movie possible.
Yeah, that's inexcusable. You can't kill Rocky Balboa like that.
Yeah.
It would have been a disservice to the character.
I mean, and it would have been going against the whole theme of the series, which is like the perseverance.
Perseverance, underdog can overcome.
Like, exactly.
So at least we have that. It could have been worse, see?
It could have been worse.
There's our silver lining for Rocky V. It could have been worse.
I have to say there were a couple of things I liked about it. I mean, I love that they brought back Burgess Meredith for that scene. I mean, it's very cheesy seeing Rocky's like, he was an angel, you know?
Yeah, but it's good seeing him again.
It was really great seeing, just to have that moment where Rocky realizes where he's come from and who helped him out. And I thought that was really nice. And I liked the Tony Duke Evers character, I'm hoping I'm getting the name right, is this kind of Apollo stand-in for Rocky and helps train him. I enjoyed that character. I think they had to change his name because you have George Washington Duke.
Which begs the question, why did they call him George Washington Duke in the first place?
I have no clue. Like, they could have called him George Washington something else.
They could have called him George Washington Fluffernutter, for all we care. It could have been anything.
It's just sloppy. I think it's, yeah, they wanted the money. They slapped this together. Just, yeah, it's kind of sad. And Adrienne's character, again, like, just loses.
She's clearly checked out of the films. Like, she's coming back here. Talia Shire clearly needed a paycheck. She's as invested here. No, she's less invested than she was in Rocky IV, and she was barely checked into Rocky IV.
It's tough. I think also some of the points of the story kind of had to happen. Like, he needed to become a mentor and have a protege. That was just the natural progression of things.
Correct.
He needed to have that doubt from Adrienne again. Just that was necessary. And then the riches to rags storyline also kind of had to happen because he needed to get back to his roots. Rocky as like a wealthy, famous boxer just didn't work.
No, it wasn't as effective.
It wasn't as effective. And also like the whole storyline with Rocky Jr. getting bullied and then, you know, starting to fight and all that stuff, that seemed also necessary as well. But it's just, you start hating the characters. Like, in this one, I just wanted to punch Polly, like, really badly. And, like, in this
Polly
one,
Polly was back to, like, they really brought everybody, they tried to bring everybody back to their original characters. And they tried to make Polly the drunk scumbag again. But even when he was a drunk scumbag, he was still making points.
Yes.
And he had narrative value.
Yeah.
Here he's just miserable.
Yes. It's just, ugh. And I mean, even like Rocky Jr. becomes annoying. And
oh yeah, when he gets his friend and gets in with the crowd there at school, and if you didn't hate him enough, again, I keep harping on the dialogue, but there were scenes with his girlfriend there.
Yeah,
that went on for 5-10 minutes. It felt like, and you listen to this, like, somebody sat down and wrote these lines. Somebody then spoke them. Somebody then edited them together. And it's like, you know what? That'll stay. The checks and balances didn't happen in Rocky V.
Yeah. It had potential as a movie. Maybe not even a Rocky movie. It had a potential as a boxing movie. Separate from the series, with some more time and attention paid to it, but an entry in the Rocky series that seemed kind of rushed and slapdash just does not work.
No. Nope, nope. And I think I've had enough of Rocky V.
Yeah.
Yeah. So let's move on to bigger and better things.
Oh, can I just make a short comment here about how Mike Sheehan, who plays Merlin Sheets, who's like one of George Washington Duke like posse, he looks exactly like Mike Huckabee. Like I was like, did Mike Huckabee have like a long lost brother?
I didn't think about that, but that's true.
It threw me off. But I mean, not any political commentary, just like he just looked like him.
Just the fact. Just reminisce. Yeah. Though, you know, political, insert your own political commentary here about that.
Yeah.
Moving on. So Rocky V happened, so Rocky VI could also exist, because Sylvester Stallone decided to make Rocky VI, a.k.a. Rocky Balboa, because he didn't feel like Rocky V was a justifiable end to the character or the series. So Rocky Balboa was released December 20th, 2006, 16 years after Rocky V. It was made for only $24 million, grossed $70 million in the U.S. So despite the layoff, fans still came back for Rocky VI.
Who was the greatest? Who was the best of all time? If two athletes from different eras could actually compete against one another, who would come out on top? In one corner, the reigning champion at Mason the Line Dixon. He'll be pitted against the former two-time heavyweight champion, Rocky Balboa. Computer says Rocky Balboa would be triumphant.
I think there's still some stuff in the basement.
What basement?
In here. I think I want to, like, fight. You know, nothing big. Small stuff, like, locally.
What are you trying to prove, Pop?
I thought you might want to get involved.
Don't you think you're too, you know, old?
I think your brain's losing altitude.
You heard Rocky Balboa applied for a license. You want me to fight a guy that I can beat with both hands tied behind my back?
That computer fight got a lot of people curious.
Yeah, but I ain't interested in getting, like, mangled and embarrassed.
People are going to think you're going crazy.
What's crazy about standing toe-to-toe saying I am?
If this is something that you got to do, then you do it. Fighters fight.
To beat this guy, you need speed. You don't have it. You've got calcium deposits on most of your joints, so sparring is out.
I had that problem.
So what we'll be calling on is blunt force trauma. Heavy-duty punches that will rattle his ancestors. Let's start building some hurting bombs.
Yeah! Yeah! We playing! We playing! What's up?
Hockey, the press has labeled you a Balboa-saurus. How do you feel about that?
It's a fight! It's a fight! Head-buster! Head-buster! We gonna hit him with the...
Larry, why is this billed as an exhibition?
So they wouldn't have to call it an execution.
It's a fight! Head-buster! Head-buster! It's a fight!
It takes guts climbing back in that ring knowing you're gonna take a beating.
Ain't nothing over till it's over.
Where's that from? The 80s?
That's probably in the 70s.
Rocky Balboa.
Can you do it?
It was warmly received by the critics as a return to old Rocky form, and there's probably good reason for that, because it was, by and large, a rehash of similar themes that went over well in Rocky I. So what'd you think? Was it a worthy return?
Jay, I'm kind of disappointed in you.
What?
Because you didn't start the segment by saying it was sponsored by GoldenPalace.com.
You know, Raquel, thank you very much for reminding me. I do have something for Golden Palace here. Let me cue that up and we'll continue with our podcast. I would have been in big trouble if I'd forgotten our sponsors.
Friday, the customer's always right, except at the Golden Palace.
They can either eat my lasagna or kiss my butt.
But does your butt come with soup and salad?
The Golden Palace.
Well, anyways, I mean, I actually really enjoyed Rocky Balboa as a coda to the series. That's how I saw it. I didn't see it as like Rocky VI. I saw it as, you know, just a look at way ahead of time of where Rocky is now. I wasn't surprised, but it made sense to kill off the Adrian character.
For Talia Shire's sake, if nothing else.
And also, I read somewhere that she was actually going to be involved, and when he was writing, I want to say Sylvester Stallone wrote the script for this one, that it just didn't have enough emotional impact with her in it, so he had discussed it with Talia Shire, and she was okay with removing the character. And also, it gives him some... not charm, but you start to feel for him more because he's suffered this tragedy and he has to continue, and that's pretty grim. I mean, a lot of the film is very grim, like look about aging and growing old and not feeling your worth.
Yeah.
But it had a lot of things going for it. I thought it was interesting to bring back that character from number one, the little girl who yells at him.
Mm-hmm.
And bring her as a character, Marie, and although that was kind of weird too, like she's sort of a love interest, but not really because he's still devoted to Adrian. But she supports him in a way that Adrian could no longer. So that, I thought that was interesting. And I really did like the look of the look at the progression of life and how difficult that is. And I appreciated that theme. And of course, there was some boxing in it.
Yeah, Sylvester Stallone wrote and directed this film. He, as I said, he did it specifically to erase the taste of Rocky V.
It was Rocky the Redemption.
Yes. There's a lot of themes and imagery that would carry over into Creed as well.
Mm hmm.
So as this is a concluding chapter in the Rocky saga, it is also almost a prequel to Creed because you have some of those same threads of Rocky coming to terms with aging and mortality and what does he have left to give. And in Rocky Balboa, it's determined that he still has the fight left. And there's no way around it. So he goes and commits to this fight, which is sort of spurned on by an ESPN boxing simulation saying that he would have beat Antonio Tarver, the real-life boxer. Mason the Lion Dixon is the character in the film. This could aging, retired Rocky Balboa stand in a ring with this boxer in his prime, which is sort of the setup for Rocky One. On the different end of the aging spectrum, you had the non-existent boxer who just takes on D-level opponents. Could he stand in a ring with the champ? So we bring back the underdog spirit of Rocky One and tell it at the opposite end of his life. And there's a nice story here, aside from all the boxing. The way he follows the date from Rocky One, he does the same routine. Goes to the ice rink, pretends to skate around in the rink that's not there anymore, with Pauly complaining the whole time, like, do you have to do all this? And of course he's saying, yes, I do, because we're still alive. We do these routines. This is the way we mourn. It's a very sentimental look at this retired, aging boxer.
This would have a lot of nostalgia.
Right.
Like, just from, like, when it was released and how far we are from the first movie, that's a really important aspect of the film.
So Rocky's going through the motions again, just as the audience is revisiting the character and that first movie. So like you said, there is a definite, it's not even cloaked nostalgia. Like we're not saying like, here's a movie that sounds and looks like Rocky. We're having the character mourning his life, mourning the people he's lost, and going through the motions again himself. The fight, again, is sort of a secondary concern. It's a requirement because it's a Rocky film, so we have to have him fight someone. In this case, it's... Again, the fight isn't nearly as interesting as anything else in the film.
And they tried to make it very much about boxing as much as they could. I mean, they were inspired by... Like, Stallone was inspired by different moments in boxing history. Like, there's the Muhammad Ali, Rocky Marciano computer-generated fight. So that inspired the computer-generated fight in the movie. And then there was the... I know I had read it was also inspired by the George Foreman-Michael Moore fight.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's also the fact that... Rocky now has Adrian's the restaurant, and he's doing that. That's something that boxers did. I know that I'd read that it was inspired by Jack Dempsey, but also Rocky Graziano, not to be confused with Rocky Marciano. Rocky Graziano had a restaurant himself in Miami, and that's one of the things he did is he entertained his patrons with stories of his boxing days.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's interesting that they try to put as many real... I mean, it's kind of a stretch that someone at this advantage age is going to be in a boxing match, but they did try to put as much real connections to the boxing world as possible.
Yeah, it's a little hard to process the actual fight in the film.
Yeah. And also, I mean, it was very... Like, I was disappointed in how the fight was... not filmed, but presented with the weird black and white and the spot color.
Yeah.
I was like, okay.
I didn't think much of the actual fight itself in this one.
Yeah.
You know where it's going. Rocky can't win the fight.
Yeah.
Just like he couldn't win the fight in the first one.
And that's interesting about the Rocky movies that I wasn't expecting is that he doesn't always win.
No.
But he always does win. He wins something. He might not win the match, but he wins life.
Right.
Or something more metaphysical.
Well, that's why we've always focused on the Rocky films, the better ones anyway, as something other than boxing.
Yes.
Whether it was a love story, redemption, there's more to it than just boxing, which is why the films still endure. If they were just movies about a boxer.
Yeah. In fact, all sports movies have to be about the sport, but about something else too, because otherwise they don't really translate.
Right. There's no resonance.
Yeah.
The end of the movie I thought was a nice capper too. Like the very end of the film, after the boxing is finished, after we have the obligatory decision and the technical loss for Rocky. Rocky goes home and visits Adrian's grave again, and he thanks her for helping him through life.
Yeah. Oh, I was a sobbing mess at that point.
Right.
You know, I could have done nothing without you. Yo, Adrian, we did it. We did it.
Because, again, he's not thanking her. I mean, we're focused on the boxing. He's not thanking her for supporting his career.
Mm-hmm.
His life was boxing. So he returns, thanks her for the life. And this is meant to be the end of the Rocky character, which is the way it should be. Rocky and Adrian. And he tosses in one more, yo, Adrian, we did it. For good measure. But it's an effective conclusion.
And also, it just ties in with the whole theme of the movie of Rocky being a boxer with heart. I mean, that's the theme of all of them, but it really is driven home here. Especially with his relationship with Marie.
Mm-hmm.
Rocky's just a really good guy.
Right, through everything. He's always been an upright citizen, even though he's done lesser things over the course of his life. He still has the best of intentions, whether he doesn't always succeed.
It also makes you hate Rocky Jr., who's just a little shit in this movie.
Yeah, he is.
I mean, he was a little shit in Rocky V, but he's like even... I mean, there's a reason behind it. And this one, he's just an ass.
It's a little too much. I found that to be slightly false. It's a forced division between the characters. It's equally as awkward as the relationship with Marie, which seems, you know... It benefits
it, more genuine.
It's right. That's more genuine and organic within the story. We find it a little bit odd, because it doesn't fall into any of our traditional expectations for the way these kind of characters would interact.
Right.
So while this is effective, the uneasy nature of their relationship as. That's not even a mentor kind of situation. He wants to help her.
It's basically a pseudo romance,
right?
It's,
without the actual sexy times.
And
it's the support mechanism that he needs. And then he finds a relationship with her son in ways that he can't with his own son.
And I think it was a bit of a stretch to be like, oh, this is the girl from the first movie, you know?
Hey, remember her?
Yeah.
And we're really trying to rekindle that Rocky flame in an audience that may not have grown up with Rocky.
Right.
This is an entirely new generation. You have to sell Rocky all over again. While making sure that the old audience gets what they want.
I think it works better in Creed with a new character, but with the connection to the previous ones, it worked a lot better in this one. I mean, I really liked their relationship, but it confused me. And also the start of it felt kind of like a stretch of the imagination.
Yes. There's a lot of convenience and forced character motivation in Rocky Balboa. The overall it's a satisfactory film and a welcome conclusion.
Yes.
It doesn't rank up there. It's not as fun as 3 or 4. It's not as good as 1 and 2. But after suffering the vicious defeat of Rocky V, we're happy. we're overjoyed to have this capper.
It needed to happen.
Yes.
And in fact, I really think that it would have been a good idea to make this film even without Rocky V, if that had never been made. Just having this as a coda to the story would have been, I think, would have been nice.
Yeah.
Rocky
V could just cease to exist, and it wouldn't have necessarily changed Rocky Balboa.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe we can do that. Maybe we just will it out of existence.
Yeah, that would be nice. And this had some of the some cheesy moments. Like, you had Mike Tyson in there. You had the goldenpalace.com, which is something I totally remember from that era. Yeah. One thing that drove me nuts was when Mason the Lion Dixon and Rocky are being introduced for the final fight, how the music for Rocky is High Hopes. And then Mason Dixon gets... like 3-6 Mafia.
Yeah.
I mean, it was so bad. That was so bad. I was like, oh.
It was a missed opportunity.
Yeah.
I'm not sure about why. You know, I mean, I understand how it functions, how they used it to introduce the character. Well, not introduce, but hammer home where Rocky is in his current life. Like, oh, it's nice to be here, and I'm hopeful that I can... get in the ring and, you know, survive with this prime aged boxing champion. That'll be nice. But yeah, at the same time, it's still a movie. We could, you know, it's funny that happens, but you want, you know, something a little bit more exciting for Rocky's entrance. It seemed like a bit of a letdown. I kind of chuckled.
It's
a moment of levity, but it's not entirely effective.
Yeah. It just did not go right.
Yeah. Well,
exit was a lot better.
Yeah. Yeah.
I do have to say we have to talk about the training montage though, because
yes, it's essential. We've
talked about every single training montage, but mm-hmm. this one I actually thought was a decent montage because it really addressed the fact that he's a lot older and he's got, you know, like this trainer is going through all the points, like, you know, this doesn't work. So we're going to build some hurtin' bombs, mm-hmm. right? Like blunt force trauma. So they're talking about like just pure strength. That's the last thing he's got for this fight.
Right.
And I like how the training sequence made references to previous training sequences. So I thought that was fantastic.
Mm-hmm. I like that you focus so heavily on the training in these films.
My favorite part.
No, I think it's great because you've shifted the focus into something that I hadn't thought about in the way that the training montage in Rocky and the way that his training evolves through the films. Mm-hmm. And there's some very interesting things to take away just specifically from these montages. And the Rocky Balboa montage, well, the whole training itself is interesting because, as you said, they're focusing on his age, as the film does. And they're focusing on the ways that he can compete, which is, you know, you can't outlast anymore. There's no way for you to survive the physical stress of the fight. So you have to rely on pure twitch strength mm-hmm. to take it out of him. And it's great to have that anchor in Duke who keeps the through line, basically.
Yeah. Yeah, especially when you're missing Apollo.
Yeah, you're missing a lot of characters, but you still have that anchor.
Yeah.
And that's important to the nostalgia factor, too. I mean, he's a secondary character that just survived long enough to make it through the films, you know.
Right.
There's an emotional attachment to the way that he's used from a viewing standpoint.
Mm-hmm.
The familiarity. If he has someone new training him in Rocky Balboa, I think the training sequence loses all of its weight. There's no callback. There's no remnants left of that Apollo Rocky relationship.
And also with Duke, he's aged with Rocky,
yes.
So he understands physically what he has to overcome in order to do this, whereas a young new trainer would not get it.
Mm-hmm.
Not that any of the trainers are really young. I mean, really, they're boxers who have retired, who are training. I mean, that's pretty much the progression of things if you want to stay in boxing. But still, just the fact that they're both kind of aged together, it just made sense to have him there.
Mm-hmm. You know all there is to know about fighting, so there's no sense us going down that same old road again. To beat this guy, you need speed. You don't have it. And your knees can't take the pounding, so hard running is out. And you got arthritis in your neck, and you've got calcium deposits on most of your joints, so sparring is out. So what we'll be calling on is good old-fashioned blunt force trauma, horsepower, heavy-duty cast-iron pile-driving punches that will have to hurt so much they'll rattle his ancestors. Every time you hit him with a shot, it's got to feel like he tried kissing the express train. Yeah. Let's start building some hurting bombs.
I mean, I'm out of Rocky Balboa notes. I'm exhausted. I feel like
we've done a lot. I mean, this has been its own training montage.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just preparing for this epic.
We should do our own separate montage of vocal exercises and note taking and Rocky watching. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, we've exhausted the Rocky franchise. We didn't touch upon Creed, but I don't feel like that's essential. We mentioned a little bit. You know, Rocky is not the central figure in that, so I kept it outside the scope of this podcast.
It does have a lot of Rocky in it, though, I have to say.
It does. And like I said, the character is a direct continuation of where he is in Rocky Balboa. He's got the restaurant and the same routines. And, you know, I think Rocky Balboa was important to Creed.
Yes.
And the inspiration behind that film.
And I thought Creed was a very good movie.
I think so too. I think it took what worked about Rocky and really updated it well.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said, I feel like that Rocky and Apollo Creed relationship is very important to the films, and that comes back in Creed, and you feel it the same way as an audience. It doesn't feel like a different film.
Mm-hmm.
When I was impressed, having watched through all the Rocky films, and then I watched Creed again, thinking that it would feel jarring coming out of the Rocky films and then jumping ahead 10 years, different writer, different director. You're dealing with Ryan Coogler now, who came to Sylvester Stallone and asked basically for his permission to continue the character, the story of Apollo Creed and his son. And asked him if he would, you know, participate. And he thought it was great and said, I'll do it. And he's in the movie. And I think it's a seamless transition.
Yeah.
I don't think that's something that can be overlooked either in valuing Creed. And that even though it feels very familiar, you're telling a new story. And it doesn't feel like something outside the Rocky universe.
It doesn't, and this whole series, I mean, they are sequels, continuations, whatever you want to call them, but they're also episodes in Rocky's whole life, and I think that makes it work for Creed. Like, this is just another stage in Rocky's life. I know that they wanted to continue the series, and part of it, they had to come up with a new story, but it doesn't feel forced. It feels like, oh, this is just the next chapter.
Right. And Ryan Coogler had a story to tell.
Yeah.
And he told it through this venue.
Mm-hmm.
And with this new character who struggles with the name Creed, which is, yeah. You know, they touched on this really lightly they hammered it home with Rocky's son, how difficult it was to have the name Balboa.
Yeah.
And as we said, that felt false. The whole thing came off. He was working in a business world, and they all they wanted to talk about what is his dad, and he never could be his own person, and he was kind of a character. So we didn't buy it. This time, with Michael B. Jordan struggling with the legacy of Apollo Creed, it works. And that's... Yeah. I mean, we see how it failed in Rocky Balboa, so now we get the real thing.
But yeah, no, I had no expectations for Creed, and I really enjoyed it.
Yep. And there's more coming, and Sylvester Stallone is still in there.
Are they filming something now?
I don't know if they've started filming, but it's in production.
Okay, that's cool. I'm glad that you challenged me to watch all the Rocky movies, because this was quite fun. I like a good challenge.
I like it when we can look at a series in its entirety and talk about the ways that the ebbs and flows and. I think it helps put everything in perspective, especially when you're dealing with movies from a certain time period. It's hard to really judge their impact on the population, among the people, unless you go back through and look at them in steps.
It wouldn't have made sense just to talk about Rocky One. It really wouldn't. You need to talk about the whole series.
Because if you just talk about Rocky One, you're just missing out on so many montages.
Yes. That keep getting better. Mm-hmm. Until one point.
Yeah. So now your final challenge for the Cinema Shame podcast our first ever series tackling Sin and Shame podcast. Now you must rank them.
Okay. I would say Rocky 1 is number 1 for me.
Yeah.
Rocky 3 is number 2, just based off of the enjoyable factor.
Mm-hmm.
And then I would put Rocky 4 as number 3 for me because I enjoyed that also very much. I would put maybe Rocky Balboa in number 4. And then I would put Rocky 2. Although that's maybe Rocky Balboa and Rocky 2 tie because I thought they were both good movies.
Mm-hmm.
But I thought Rocky 2 had some issues. And then Rocky 5 at the bottom, of course. And that's mostly just personal gut reaction. Like, I would put Rocky 1 first just because it's the start and it what hooked me in. And without it, I can't appreciate the other ones. So inherently, it's going to be the best. But 3 and 4, just, like, they battle for the second spot because they're so good. I just enjoyed them so much. I mean, they're flawed movies. I mean, there's things wrong with them, but it's just I had so much fun watching
right.
them.
Right.
Just
they're
enjoyable.
There's a lot that could have been done. I'll say this. There's a lot that could have been changed about Rocky 3 and 4. But,
yes.
But that does not in any way take away from their entertainment factor.
Yeah. And you have to have the entertainment factor. You have to be enjoying these movies. And there's so many elements of 3 and 4 that I just hooked me in and just made me just really enjoy them.
Mm-hmm.
And I think what threw me off of Rocky 2 is kind of maybe the over sentimentality of some of the scenes, like the coma and the whole, like, rags to riches overspending, and some of that stuff is just like, oh,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah, it's okay. Fairly obvious what you're doing here, Rocky 2. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I get it. But you still have, like, the Adrian character is still great in number 2. We just kind of lose that specialness in the following movies, but she's just such a great character in 1 and 2. So that makes those special.
And the acting in 2 is still at that Rocky caliber. It's the screenplay that lets the movie down a little bit. But
I also think that inherently her character didn't have a lot to give anyway to the story. I mean, just, I think it's in the first two, I mean, she's his love interest, then she's his new wife, but eventually she's just his wife. And I feel like story wise, it just wasn't ever going to be interesting.
Yeah, no, there's really nowhere to go with that, with her once she's his wife.
Yeah.
Leaving him is not really in the cards here.
Then
you're dealing with an entirely different set of circumstances that you don't really want to get into with the Rocky films. I mean, that takes the focus completely away. And then, you know, dying was the necessary transition to make Rocky 6 have that emotional connection to her character again. Otherwise, mm-hmm. she's still just around, you know. Like you said, there's very little interesting they can do that felt true to her character once they were married.
Right.
You're rehashing the same, like, don't you dare get in the ring again. I'm going to get in the ring again. Well, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's. I mean, I don't know how they could have broken away from that without changing some aspect of Adrian's character.
Yeah, not in any way that would have felt reasonable. So.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Well, why don't you? We haven't done this. Why don't you plug your blog, since you are the ultimate blogger? We've come to the end of this saga. Now tell us what you do.
So I run the blog Out of the Past. It's outofthepastblog.com. Hopefully that's easy to remember. And I've been writing for 10 years on the blog, and I mostly write about classic movies from the 1920s to the 1960s, but I've started to branch out into some TV and some 70s and 80s.
Perfect.
Yeah.
On your blog, you have your name up there, I presume. I no longer want it to say Raquel Stecher.
You wanted to say Raquel, the ultimate blogger. That sounds so pretentious, though.
It's hugely pretentious.
Well, just such a Hulk Hogan thing, but it's not, I don't know. Maybe I regret saying it already.
You'll think about it. You will. Thank you for coming on the podcast, sharing multiple episodes and all of your thoughts about Rocky 1 through 6.
And thank you for the challenge. This was so much fun.
What did you say to the kid? It ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit. And keep moving forward. How much you can take. And keep moving forward. Get up.
Let's go, get up!
Chosen.